Welcome, everyone, to this year's virtual Walk of the Cross. We hope that this time spent reflecting on the images, music, and memories helps to make this Good Friday gathering special and our faith strengthened as we walk together in our hearts and homes.
Jesus went as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down, and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer and went back to the disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked them. "Get up and pray so that you will not fall into temptation." Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, we, your people, come together on this Good Friday in remembrance of your suffering and death. As we walk with you, grant that through the power of your Holy Spirit, we may enter more deeply into your work of salvation. Amen.
Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him in your presence and have found no basis for your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. As you can see, he has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and then release him." And with one voice they cried out, "Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us." Barabbas had been thrown into prison for an insurrection in the city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" For the third time he spoke to them, "Why? What crime has this man committed? For I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty. Therefore I will have him punished and then release him." But with loud shouts they insistently demanded that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant their demand. He released the man who'd been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they had asked for, and surrendered Jesus to their will. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, many times we are blind to who you are. You came amongst us to show us the way to eternal life. Today we are reminded of how we remain indifferent to your message. Very often we crucify you by our words and our actions. Help us to see that you are the one who saves us, that you are the way, the truth, and the life. Amen.
The soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. Here they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side and Jesus in the middle. John 19, verses 16 to 18. The prophet Isaiah spoke of the suffering servant, the suffering just man. This prophecy was fulfilled perfectly in Jesus. He took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Isaiah 53, verses 4 to 6. In his first letter, Peter describes the redeeming work of Jesus in this way. To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. 1 Peter 2, verses 21 to 24. Matthew 16, verse 24. Lord Jesus Christ, you have said, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Help us to see in the sufferings, shortcomings, and sacrifices of our lives a share in your cross. Strengthen and console us in the belief that we bear all things in union with you, who have taken upon yourselves the weight of our sins and those of our whole world. Amen.
The following are known as the last seven words of Jesus, as recorded in the Gospels. He spoke them during his three-hour agony on the cross. To the repentant thief, I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise. To his mother, woman, here is your son. And to his disciples, here is your mother. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. I am thirsty. My God, why have you forsaken me? Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. It is done. Let us pray. God, our Father, in your plan of salvation, your Son, Jesus Christ, accepted the cross and freed us from the power of the enemy. May we and all your people remain faithful till death and come to share the glory of his resurrection. Grant this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
We read in John 19, verse 30. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said, "It is accomplished." Then he bowed his head and died. St. Paul sums up the mystery of salvation in the beautiful words of this early Christian hymn, as recorded in his letter to the Philippians. Though he was in the form of God, Christ Jesus did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Thank you.
While we would usually gather inside the church and then be invited to come forward to the cross and to reverence it in keeping with its meaning as a sign of Christ's sacrifice for our salvation, we could take a moment wherever we find ourselves today and reflect on the power of the cross and what it means to us in our lives and in our homes. We are also able to quietly entrust to the Lord our burdens and concerns, uniting the experience of the cross in our own lives with the saving cross of Jesus. Let's close in a word of prayer. Let us pray. O God of eternal glory, you anointed Jesus, your servant, to bear our sins, to encourage the weary, to raise up and restore the fallen. Keep before our eyes the splendor of your Son and the wonder of the gift of salvation in him. Continue to heal and transform our world through the power of his cross and resurrection. We ask this through Christ, the one who sets us free from sin, Satan, and death, and who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, holy and mighty God, forever and ever. Let us join in the prayer which unites us as Christian sons and daughters of God. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Thank you for joining together on this Good Friday. May your day be blessed and faith strengthened for having participated in this virtual event.
Shoulders shake.